To start, Jai Baba, everybody. So, Ashok, you want to read?
Yeah, actually, definitely.
Sure, pleasure.
Avtar Meher Baba Ki Jai, the seven realities, existence, love, sacrifice, renunciation, knowledge, control, and surrender. I give no importance to creed, dogma, caste, or the performance of religious ceremonies and rites, but to the understanding of the following seven realities. One, the only real existence is that of the one and only God, who is the self in every finite self. Two, the only real love is the love for this infinity God, which arouses an intense longing to see, know, and become one with its truth, God. Three, the only real sacrifice is that in which, in pursuance of this love, all things, body, mind, position, welfare, and even life itself are sacrificed. Four, the only real renunciation is that which abandons, even in the midst of worldly duties, all selfish thoughts and desires. Five, the only real knowledge is the knowledge that God is the inner dweller in good people and in so-called bad, in saint and in so-called sinner. This knowledge requires you to help all equally as circumstances demand, without expectation of reward, when compelled to take part in a dispute, to act without the slightest trace of enmity or hatred, to try to make others happy with brotherly or sisterly feeling for each one, and to harm no one in thought, word, or deed, not even those who harm you. Six, the only real control is the discipline of the senses to abstain from indulgence in lower desires, which alone ensures absolute purity of character. Seven, the only real surrender is that in which poise is undisturbed by any adverse circumstance, and the individual amidst every kind of hardship is resigned with perfect calm to the will of God. Avtar Meher Baba Ki Jai.
Great, thank you. So how's everybody today? I hope all doing well. So quick reaction to something that popped up in the message stream in Telegram, right? Semantic satiation. So are we facing semantic satiation with reading the seven realities every day? So that's something to ponder about. But that is what my mind was repeatedly getting reminded when we were reading this. So just something for us to think about, right? Are we doing this monotonously? And if so, what are the ways? What are the ways to make this better, make this real, and relate to this in a better manner? I see a couple of mics unmuting. Please go ahead. I said yes.
I actually, when you were reading, I'll be honest. This is honesty to the Baba more than to anybody else, and myself more than anybody else. I was switched off when Ashok was reading it. I was doing something else. So it has become monotonous. There has to be meaning to it, and we have to.
Yes.
I think we have to discuss how we apply it more than just reading it.
Agreed.
So just my part. Sorry, Baba.
Great honesty. That's the way I look at it. And I agree with that too. There have been times when I use that time to set something up, fix something that I've not done, so on and so forth. And quite often my mind is not there, and that's not just right. Right. And so I think let's think of what to do to, make that wholesome. I do not deny that the intent with which we started this probably is still relevant. I totally think the intent is still intact. That is of trying to...
Jai Baba.
Yeah, Sanjay, go ahead.
Yeah, it's not just about the seven realities. Even the book that we are reading.
Sure.
I do get distracted, actually. Something or other keeps cropping up. So refocus on what we are reading, because the discourse itself is the same words of Baba as the message of seven realities. So yes. It's about everything that we are doing. It's not just about the first message.
Yeah. True. In that sense, yes. I'm probably least distracted. I understand what you mean. There have been times when I joined other Baba meetings and then something pops up on the phone, somebody does something else, you mute and so on and so forth. So the problem is larger, I don't deny, of mindfully doing something. But I think on the reading itself, I've seen very high engagement, right? At least three or four of you are completely onto it and so on. And of course, for me, the advantage is I'm reading, so I'm fully on it, right? But Sunil has a point. We'd like to think of what ways to improve this.
One suggestion is to keep doing the process. Can we read something different every time? His wishes, how to love God, things like that. So that forces you to concentrate. Or that is one way of doing it. Yes.
So we can go to Sunil's presentation and do different slides each time, right? You can rotate. Right?
Yeah.
That's something like that.
That's a good idea.
Good idea. It happens with the prayers also, actually. Many times I am, continuing with a meeting, just finish the meeting just before 7, just jump into in front of Baba's picture and start reciting prayer. But the mind is still engaged with I was doing or what I'm expected to be doing after my prayers. So that problem is there. But I think last week and before we were reading about meditation, that's probably, I think, if I start practicing, may help. Focusing the mind on one subject at a time, which is what it is actually.
Yeah. Actually, when we do family get together, family Zoom meetings, what we do before reading like discourses or something, we read there are a lot of books like While the World Slept, like one or two pages, you know. Bhav Kalchuri's experiences while he was night watchman, something like that. And what is the other book? He writes great books. The person who wrote, there are 1, 2, 3, 4 volumes there.
Glimpses of God, man. Glimpses of God.
Rustum Falati books, you know. Something like that we can read. Certainly that will make us focus more. And each topic of that may take about 5 minutes, but still we all can focus what is being read. And that certainly gives a message, strong message.
So I thought of Lord Meher, a page of Lord Meher a long time back, given that we have sustained so long, we have made some progress there as well. But I did not pursue that because I think doing something on the lines of, setting the stage for learning, which means maybe read a special message, read a prayer, read something. That's more important than just reading from text from another book is my vote. Sanjay, go ahead.
Yeah, my vote is actually these books like Rustam Falati's book or Tirach's book like Determined to Be His, gives the actual practical context that things happened, actually. It So Happened is also a book by Rich. So once in a while, it is good to connect, and because it gives you a real-life examples of what Baba did and what Baba said during the actual real-life situations, actually, rather than just the theory.
Yeah. Reading seven realities every time. That also we are reading. If you want to have a prayer, we can always do a short prayer. The third prayer, we can always do that. That takes less than a minute. And then read something like that. That will
That's a good idea. Best of all worlds, yeah. Makes sense. Cool.
I have one thought or question.
Sure.
We call it. We get pearls every day, right?
Yeah.
Karthik has been very diligently sending those pearls. Does anybody get any reaction to them, or is everybody listening to them, or any thoughts on them? I don't know. I listen to them intently every day.
Yes, I wait for it and listen to that every day morning.
Right. It's almost like morning tea nowadays, Karthik. Yeah. So I was just thinking, shouldn't we briefly discuss what was said in the last week's pearls, or if anybody has any reaction, thoughts, ideas, because these are all...
That's a good idea. That's a very good idea. I've thought about that many times as I listen to it. Mm-hmm. I'm so eager to see what others thought about it.
Yeah, exactly.
I just want to say, hey, do you know, this is fantastic, isn't it, Sunil? This is fantastic.
Right.
Because it might be relevant to different people in the group. You're right.
Right. Today was that provisional ego, right?
So, that's brilliant.
Brilliant, yeah. Right. Very easy.
So many times from...
the pursuit should go beyond this accumulating knowledge.
Yeah.
How was it applied? How was that knowledge applied in past? And very fantastic stories that either Baba has narrated or from Baba's lifetime in those pearls also. So maybe just one idea. Thank you.
Good idea. Padna bhi padega abhi humko.
So we are starting from the third chapter, Types of Meditation. I'll quickly cover what we did in the part two before proceeding. So if you look at the three we saw that there were three principles of classification of types of meditation, and the two of them were covered here, two principles. So in the first principle, it was associative and disassociative. And the second principle was about the discriminative meditation and meditation of heart and action. And now we go to the third one, the third principle in the part three, right? So any questions, any thoughts before we go there?
I want to add something. Can I see, while we're reading meditation, similarly, attending this meeting and being in the totally one in the meeting is also a practical meditation. I mean, what I'm saying is that when we are doing this sessions, of course, all of us may have some other priorities, but as far as possible, if we are in the meeting and 100% concentrating on what is being the proceedings of the meeting and what is being, you know, read and discussed, is also a form of meditation.
Undoubtedly.
When you concentrate on the one, I think we should also, of course, we are reading the theory, and as bridging the theory with practice is the most important thing.
Fair enough. Absolutely. Yeah, so the my bringing that up was exactly that. I'm glad many people are thinking like me, or at least had the same reservation. So we'll come up with something. And anyway, just a reminder, tomorrow's second half of our meeting is devoted to meditation. I think Nomita is not on the call, but then I'll remind her and make sure we do that. Right? Okay, so let's get on with it and start reading. 2, 3, 4. Okay, somebody's mic needs to, Mamaji, your mic needs to mute. So part three, general classification of the forms of meditation. Jai Baba, let's get started. Meditation is universal. The process of meditation aims at understanding and transcending the wide and varied range of experience. When meditation is interpreted in this manner, it is at once seen to be something that is not peculiar to a few aspirants. It turns out to be a process that every living creature in some way is engaged in. The tiger, intent upon devouring a lamb that it has spied, meditates upon the lamb. The lamb, in its turn, having sighted the tiger, meditates upon the tiger. The passenger who waits on the platform for a train is meditating upon the train, and the driver of the train, expecting to be relieved at the next station, is meditating upon the station. The scientist who works upon an unsolved problem meditates upon that problem. The patient who is waiting with tense anxiety for a doctor is meditating upon the doctor. And the doctor who is awaiting payment of a bill is meditating upon the account. When a police officer tries to catch a thief, they both meditate upon each other. The person who falls in love is meditating upon the beloved. And one who is jealously watchful of a rival is meditating upon the rival. The individual struck with grief at the death of a friend is meditating upon the friend. Someone who seeks revenge upon an enemy meditates upon the enemy. The woman lost in choosing attractive clothes to wear is meditating upon herself as the body. And the man who boasts of his intellectual or psychic attainments is meditating upon himself as the mind. Spiritually important meditation. All these are in a way forms of meditation, but in spiritual discourses, the term meditation is usually restricted to those forms of meditation that tackle the problem of understanding experience intensively and systematically. In the above examples, meditation is a result of a natural application of the mind to the objects with which it is presented. In this application of the mind, the individual is almost unconscious of the ultimate purpose of the process of meditation. In the realm of spirituality, however, meditation in the initial stages, at least, is deliberate. During such meditation, the subject is more specifically conscious of the ultimate objective. Nevertheless, the forms of meditation is characteristic of the spiritual life are continuous with those found throughout the consciousness. The spiritual forms of meditation spring into existence only when the other more general forms of meditation have brought the person to a certain crisis or blind alley. Then he is forced to choose the object of meditation in the light of some spiritual ideal and must also revise the manner of meditation he may have become accustomed to. General and specialized meditation. The spiritually important forms of meditation are of two kinds. General meditation, which consists in the assimilation of the divine truths, and specialized meditation, in which the mind selects some definite item of experience and is exclusively concerned with it. General meditation is only a carrying further of the ordinary thought processes systematically and intensively. It is different from the many pre-spiritual meditations of a worldly person only insofar as the thought processes now come to be directed toward realities that have spiritual importance, and the mind makes intelligent use of the expositions of the divine truths given by those who know, without renouncing its critical powers and inherent zest for the truth. Specialized meditation is practical. The specialized forms of meditation, on the other hand, imply and require something more than a purely intellectual approach to the truth. In the specialized forms of meditation, as in general meditation, the mind has an opportunity to have an intellectual understanding of the object of meditation. But in addition, they also help to cultivate mental discipline, develop capacities hitherto dormant, and unfold latent possibilities of personality. The problem in specialized forms of meditation is not theoretical, but practical. Specialized forms of meditation are helpful for overcoming specific obstacles in the way of enlightenment and realization. They aim at controlling the mind and going beyond it. Specialized forms of meditation are more like the desperate attempts of a person to break through the walls of a prison than like the idle speculative activity involved in forming opinions about the strength of the different parts of the prison walls or what may be visible after breaking into the open. Practical purpose may prevail over formal truth. in spiritual life, even a sincere mistake taken seriously may have more value than half-hearted allegiance to theoretical or formal truth. The practical purpose in the specialized forms of meditation must sometimes prevail even at the cost of formal and theoretical truth. Thus, in meditation, while concentrating on a particular form or formula, no other form or formula can be allowed access to the mind, although intrinsically this other form or formula may have the same or even greater spiritual importance. If an aspirant has been meditating upon the form of one perfect master, he has to exclude from his mind all ideas of any other masters, though they are as perfect as the master on whom he is meditating. The formula of intensive thinking on the master can be as helpful in achieving the goal as the process of making the mind blank. Function of general meditation. As a rule, mixing up the specialized forms of meditation is not desirable, although theoretically, they may all be equally directed toward different aspects of the truth. The task of bringing together the different facets of the truth and building up a whole and complete view of life is attempted by general meditation, in which thought is free, comprehensive, and receptive to all aspects of the truth. Such general meditation has its own value and justification. General meditation is helpful before specialized forms of meditation as well as after trying them, but it cannot take the place of specialized forms of meditation because these have a different purpose and function. Both forms of meditation necessary. The different forms of specialized meditation are comparable to different forms of bodily exercise, each of which may have some specific purpose. Exercise of the muscles is meant only to strengthen the muscles, but this does not mean that the muscles are the only important part of the body. All types of exercise are important for securing the general health of the body, although it may not be possible to take all of them at the same time. The functions of the different specialized forms of exercise have, however, to be correlated and governed in the light of one's knowledge of true health or proportionate development of the body. In the same way, the functions of the specialized forms of meditation have to be correlated with and governed by the whole and complete ideal of life. This, the aspirant constructs through the process of general meditation or unrestrained thought, which knows no law except that of finding the truth in all its aspects. Just as specialized forms of meditation cannot be replaced by general meditation cannot be replaced by specialized forms of meditation. Both are necessary and have their own value. For enumerative purposes, the different specialized forms of meditation can be conveniently classified according to the third principle on the basis of those items of experience the mind tries to understand. Human experience in all its variety is characterized throughout by the dual aspect of subject and object. Some forms of meditation are concerned with the objects of experience, some are concerned with the subject of experience, and some forms of meditation are concerned with the mental operations that are involved in the interaction of the subject and the object. Thus, three kinds of meditation are defined. The subheading was different specialized meditations. Nirvana, Nirvikalpa, and Sahaja Samadhi. All the forms of meditation that the aspirant, sadhak, might adopt can ultimately culminate through the grace of a perfect master in the goal of the Nirvikalpa state. Nirvikalpa Samadhi, or divinity in expression, is the experience of the Nirvikalpa state of uninterrupted spontaneous self-knowledge of a God-realized being, Siddha. It is preceded by Nirvana or absorption in divinity. The Sadguru's experience Sahaja Samadhi or divinity in action, which is preceded by the stages of Nirvana and Nirvikalpa. Sahaja Samadhi is the effortless and continuous state of perfection of Sadgurus, while it is the very life of the avatar. There's a lot said in this last paragraph. I would like to read it again because we come across these terms quite a number of times, and I think this is brought about very beautifully here. All the forms of meditation that the aspirant might adopt can ultimately culminate through the grace of a perfect master in the goal of the Nirvikalpa state. Nirvikalpa Samadhi is the experience of the Nirvikalpa state of uninterrupted spontaneous self-knowledge of a God-realized being, Siddha. It is preceded by Nirvana or absorption in divinity. The Sadgurus experience Sahaja Samadhi or divinity in action, which is preceded by states of Nirvana and Nirvikalpa. Sahaja Samadhi is the effortless and continuous state of perfection of the Sadgurus, while it is the very life of the avatar. I think this is three things, right? So divinity in action, divinity in expression, divinity in action, and the continuous state of Sahaja Samadhi, continuous state of perfection, right?
Can somebody explain what is absorption in divinity, Nirvana?
Absorption in divinity. Anybody?
Jai Baba, I think there is something that I wanted to mention here about, I don't know whether it is the error or whether it is my interpretation. First of all, we know that discourses were dictated as periodically between 1938 to 1942. I think somebody has to mute, please, or everybody has to mute except myself. So what I want to say is that between 1938 to 1942, these discourses were dictated by Baba to be put in the journal. Then God Speaks, of course, was released in 1955. And because of the semantics of the English language, some of the terminologies can be different if you, in the discourses and God Speaks. For example, here it said, it is preceded by Nirvana, which is Nirvikalpa Samadhi is preceded by Nirvana or absorption in divinity. Now, if you look at the table, page 278 in God Speaks, which categorizes the 56 God-realized souls under the category of Madhu, Paramahamsa, Jivan Mukta, and Sadgurus. Now, Madhus and Paramahamsas are in Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Jivan Muktas and Kutubs or Sadgurus are in Sahaja Samadhi. Now, according to the definition out here, it says Nirvikalpa Samadhi is divinity in expression, which is fine because, the Madhu is God consciousness state and he is self-realized. He is experiencing the infinite knowledge, power, bliss, Satchitananda. And he kind of expresses that meaning silently. And the Paramahamsa is alternating between God consciousness and creation consciousness. So that is also in Nirvikalpa Samadhi, whereas Jivan Mukta is simultaneously and spontaneously experiencing God consciousness, which is Satchitananda Nirvikalpa Samadhi, plus he is also creation consciousness simultaneously. And the same thing happens with the Sadhguru. They are in both states, you know, simultaneously and spontaneously. There is no alternation. The difference between Jivan Mukta and Sadhguru is that Sadhguru directly works with the public. That is why it's called divinity in action. Okay? Divinity in action. So that is Sahaja Samadhi, it says. It's also called Atma Pratishthapana. But when you read God Speaks, you will notice that there is a term called Sulukya. You know, Jivan Mukta is a real Salik. Whereas Paramahamsa is either a Majzub Salik or a Salik Majzub. Real Salik Majzub or real. That means either the Majzub state is more dominant, then it's called real Majzub Salik, which is more God consciousness than creation consciousness. And if it's Salik Majzub, that means it's dominating is the creation consciousness, the body consciousness. But the funny thing is that Paramahamsa, even though he is experiencing both alternatively, and the Jivan Mukta is experiencing both simultaneously, it's considered Paramahamsa is in Nirvikalpa Samadhi and Jivan Mukta is in Sahaja Samadhi, which is also experienced by the Sadguru. The only difference between Jivan Mukta, there are two types of Jivan Mukta, you know, the perfect one and the most perfect one, Kamil and Akmal. And then Sadguru is called the supremely perfect one. Okay, this is in God Speaks, you know, page 143 or something like that. So I asked this question to Ward, you know, and during the last God Speaks thing, you know, there was a discussion. And I'm not going to go into the, I think I'll let Karthik talk about it, but he was not able to explain to me, you know, the difference, you know, why the Nirvikalpa Samadhi and Sahaja Samadhi. But now coming back to your question of absorption in divinity, see, we know from God Speaks, Nirvana is Fana. The first stage of Fana is Nirvana. What is Nirvana? Manonash, annihilation of the mind. F-A-M-N. Fana, annihilation of the mind, Manonash. And Nirvana is basically sanskaras become zero and the spiritual aspirant is in the seventh plane, but he's only experiencing the divine absolute vacuum state, and that is bliss. So according to me, Nirvana should be called absorption in bliss. Okay? Whereas Nirvikalpa Samadhi, which is actually the goal, Nirvana is a goal, but Nirvikalpa Samadhi is the goal. There's a difference here. But without Nirvana, you can't go into Nirvikalpa Samadhi because that is called the second stage of Fana. So when you come into Nirvikalpa Samadhi, the definition is you are experiencing Satchitananda, infinite power, infinite knowledge, infinite bliss, which is called God realization or self-realization. Now within this category, we have seen the Majzub and the Paramahamsa. The Majzub is not creation consciousness. He's only God consciousness, but he's in Nirvikalpa Samadhi, which is called divinity in expression, which is correct. And so what I feel is this Nirvana absorption in divinity is, at least from my understanding of the semantics of the English language, because Nirvana is only bliss, which is, let's say, one third of the Satchitananda, you know, because it's only Ananda, bliss. Because only people in Nirvana and who have got moksha, they experience bliss. They don't experience self-realization, God realization. And most souls will get liberation. Nirvana is liberation, basically. Very few souls will go from Nirvana to Nirvikalpa Samadhi. And then out of those souls who go into Nirvikalpa Samadhi, they will drop their body after 3-4 days. And then people who are destined to be part of the 56 God realized souls, then go into the categories of Majzub, Paramahamsa, Jivan Mukta, and Sadguru. This is something we need to be very cognizant of. But I would like other people to look at this, you know, and make sure that what I'm saying is correct or not. Because I just felt that the absorption in divinity is only when you have self-realization, Nirvikalpa Samadhi. But nirvana is not self-realization. You know, it is only liberation. So that's the point I wanted to make. Jai Baba.
Kama, I just have one question.
Jai Baba, Ashoka, just let me say what Mamaji asked. Very beautifully explained, Kama, except for one small detail. You're very thorough with the God speaks and all. That's great. See, absorption of the divinity is nothing but here, the sentence itself very clearly says it is preceded by nirvana or absorption in divinity. So when does this happen? From the sixth plane, when we are getting into the seventh plane at the threshold, perfect master, he pushes us by taking out all sanskaras from us. And he pushes us into the seventh plane. And what happens in the seventh plane is a state of vacuum where only consciousness exists, but there is no God there. No God, only consciousness exists and in a state of vacuum. And then we proceed to the, when we get to the state, then we proceed to the nirvikalpa state, you know. We can explain this like this. When we go to Mehrabad, what do we mean by going to Mehrabad? Actually, we mean to take a darshan in the upper Mehrabad at the Baba Samadhi, right? By going to lower Mehrabad, that's where we get down from the bus or car, whatever it is, we are going nearby. From there, we go by walk. Just like that comparison. It is a preparation to get the God realization, absorption, the divinity, because this nirvana state belongs to the world of reality, not world of duality. That is how we get absorbed in the divinity. That is just a single point I would like to. But I never read anywhere, maybe I'm wrong, Kama, we don't experience blissful state when we get the nirvana. The blissful state experiences only after nirvikalpa state. People who get mukti, they experience bliss. They leave the body completely. They are with the body for 3 to 5 days, and then they get the mukti. That means they become one with the God. That much I can say. Jai Baba.
Jai Baba, I frankly, sorry to say that, but Ravi, I did not understand what you were saying. I agree, maybe your metaphor, but I am quoting, for example, here, this passing away in, this is page 125 in God's Peace. Now that full consciousness has been fully involved, the objects of nothingness, which apparently appear to exist, vanish completely together with their impressions. With complete annihilation of impressions of the associations of the nothing, the impression consciousness of God in the man state, of God in the man state. So, you know, here it's interesting that Baba is saying every drop soul is God in the man state, is spontaneously transformed into the unimpressioned or impressionless consciousness of God, which makes God in the man state experience the passing away in this original state of absolute vacuum. Now, this original state of absolute vacuum is the state one, which is the Paratpar Parabrahma. It is but natural that the full consciousness fully involved and now free from even the slightest trace of any impression should give no other experience but that of the original absolute vacuum state of God, which once prevailed and which is now experienced consciously. So they are referring to the Paratpar Parabrahma state where you are unconscious. But once you come to state two and going through all the evolution, involution process, you are actually now experiencing that Paratpar Parabrahma state consciously. This full consciousness fully involved is the super consciousness of the Mahachaitanya, The unconscious God in the original absolute vacuum state is now fully conscious or superconscious of his original state of God in the beyond state. This passing away in the absolute vacuum of the original state of God is called attaining the fana of the seventh plane of consciousness, which I think you mentioned. In Sufi terms, fana means passing away in. Fana has two stages. The first stage of fana is the conscious experience of the absolute vacuum state. And the second stage of fana or fana phila is the conscious experience of the I am God state. Fana phila, the second stage, is the goal of God in the man state, where God in human form, that is, as man, ultimately realizes the I am God state with full consciousness. This is the state of final madzubiyat, as it is termed by the Sufis. So then what I will do is, I will read you something from the supplement regarding the bliss aspect for you.
See, fana state is only just passing away from one state to the other state. Even every day, Baba even compared, every day we are awake. And when we go into the sleep, deep sleep, we are passing away. We are experiencing the fana. And then we experience the baka. Baka means we exist in the sleep state. And in the morning, we again go through the fana baka states. Fana means passing away from the deep sleep state to the awake state, and we experience the baka of the awake state. So right. In fana is just passing away. Fana means just passing away. We don't experience anything different. It is the baka. Fana phila is the state where we experience the blissful state.
Now, is fana a nirvana state? First stage of fana?
Yes, yes. Fana and nirvana are same. Fana is the Muslim word. What is that? The Sufi word. Nirvana is the Sanskrit word. Nirvana, nirvikalpa is the Sanskrit word. Fana, phila is the Sufi word. Baka, billa. Sufi words. Nirvikalpa, samadhi.
Yes, fana, phila is nirvikalpa, samadhi. Baka, billa is sahaja, samadhi.
Sahaja samadhi. But fana, yes. After experiencing fana, we only experience the vacuum state. We don't, and this is not a God state. Only in God state, we experience infinite bliss. And when some people retain the body, just like what you explained, mazoobs, salik mazoobs, and perfect masters, sadgurus, avatars, then they experience infinite knowledge, infinite power, infinite existence, and infinite bliss. They experience that. But people who experience mukti, they don't have any body. They are not at all in this world of duality. They are in the world of reality. They become with one with the consciousness, and the God always experiences the blissful state.
Well, according to the supplement on page 243, where it talks about the four types of mukti or liberation. So let me read that. Certain well-known terms to describe various types of perfection are stated here briefly, so that the seeker may fit them into the framework of the subject of God realization. In describing these type of perfection, the key word mukti, which literally means liberation, is used here to define four types of liberation. In the following table, all the four types of liberation or mukti of the soul belong to the seventh plane. Number one, ordinary mukti, in brackets, ordinary moksha. Ordinary mukti is achieved only after death by some exceptionally God-fearing, truth-loving good souls. And this mukti usually comes 3 to 5 days after the soul has left the body. Since this mukti is attained without the body, the individual soul enjoys only bliss, anand, and although power and knowledge are there, such a mukta cannot experience them. Such a liberated soul is conscious only of the bliss of union, and for him creation no longer exists, thereby bringing to an end the constant round of births and deaths. Nirvikalpa Samadhi must not be confused with this ordinary mukti or moksha state. Should a soul reach the mukti state, it does so after the death of the physical body. Such a soul reaches God, but this occurs only after death. Thus, there is an important distinction between ordinary mukti on the one hand and nirvikalpa samadhi on the other, because the latter is experienced while the soul retains the body and thus becomes videha mukta.
There you go.
And yep. Then they go on to videha mukta, jivan mukta, and parama mukta. So I think that probably what you're saying could be right, because you're saying that ordinary moksha, which happens after death, you enjoy only bliss, which is part of the Satchitananda state. Whereas in Nirvikalpa Samadhi, you are experiencing all three. Whereas in Nirvana, you are basically only experiencing the vacuum state, which has nothing to do with bliss. So maybe you're correct, you know. So the second stage of Vana. Go ahead.
See, Baba explained one more thing. There is no such thing as where there is no God, right? Even though Baba explained, Fana is a state where there is no God, but only consciousness is.
Correct.
Even though he, in the next statement, he said that there is no such thing as where God does not exist. God exists. God is the only one who is experiencing this. So it's a contrary, but it's for us to understand that. But he is comparing the statement with the what is forthcoming in the nirvikalpa state.
Yes, it's almost like a graduation, you know.
Yes.
Whether you graduate without a PhD, it's like a nirvana, and graduating with a PhD is like nirvikalpa samadhi. You know, just an analogy, because.
Yeah, you can say that. Any.
That is nirvana means liberation. Right? Liberation. No, but nirvana, if you're talking about, is the first stage. It's a mandatory stage before nirvikalpa.
That's right.
You can't go to nirvikalpa samadhi without going to the nirvana state. So that is mandatory. And also we know that the 84 life cycles is basically the maximum number of human life cycles that a soul needs to go through to attain liberation. So all souls will automatically get liberated in the 84th lakh human cycle. But for souls that need to accelerate their process of God realization or nirvana, can with the guidance of a perfect master or avatar do it in lesser number of cycles. So because anyway, this whole game is imagination. Right? It is part of the nothing. So everything is almost pre-scripted. And that is why I think every religion quotes that the soul will get liberated anyway, you know, every soul. Only thing is there will be a difference based on their sanskaras and their power of choice and so on and so forth. Okay, Baba.
See, that is the reason in Buddhism, Buddha talked only about nirvana state, where there is vacuum state and there is no God state. That's why they say there's no God. Buddhists, they say that.
Correct. I think, you know, Buddha was very practical, because we have a choice now. First choice is, of course, you want to get out of this cycle of births and deaths, samsara, that is nirvana. And he said, like, I think nirvikalpa samadhi, if you have the goal, at least you'll get nirvana, you know, if not nirvikalpa samadhi. So I think, in a way, Buddha was very practical in his approach for all human beings, that he did not want to go into the aspect of God, because I think the human mind looks at God as an object of desire, and God is not an object of desire, because God is your own self. I think that is where a lot of people have this contradiction, or not even a contradiction. I think it distracts them from the real purpose, that your job is to reduce your sanskaras to zero, right? And automatically, if you go to nirvana, which is nirvana, then if you're destined, you can get nirvikalpa samadhi, you know.
Yeah.
Can I just add my one?
Yeah, one so you had a question. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, no, I don't have a question. I was just saying that, can we say, in short, as a corollary, that nirvana is a precondition for nirvikalpa samadhi?
Yes.
Make it simple. I mean, you know.
Preparation and, for the God realization. Yeah. Which belongs, the main thing is that belongs to, not to the world of duality, that belongs to the world of reality. That belongs to God's state.
So I would request, if it's okay, to read the supplement 25, which has got a summary of four types of mukti. That might be relevant to our discussion.
I have a friend in Minneapolis, an American, is a Baba lover. He had a second marriage, and with the first marriage, he had some older kids, and he's the only Baba lover. But anyway, he convinced his children, who are grown up, who are going to college, he believed if he once take them to the samadhi, they will become Baba lovers. So he convinced them, he bought the tickets, and then he brought them. And then they were driving from, they landed in Bombay, they rented a taxi, and the car picked them up, and they were coming. They reached Mehrabad, and they didn't go to Upper Mehrabad yet. And, you know, with all the travel and everything, they were expecting some big hotels, but Mehrabad is like, not a hotel. And they got into a fight with small things, you know. The fight went so much between father and the children, one of the kid especially. They said, I'm not going to go to Samadhi, I'm going back. She took the taxi back to Bombay and flew back to America. So nirvana means, are you sure, Ashok, you will get nirvikalpa?
Only destiny, the future will tell. I just wanted to point out, maybe later on we can do it offline. Supplement 23, 24, 25, perhaps read with page 278, 279 in the God Speaks, might be relevant to understand, because this supplement 23 gives five.
Ashok, I just read that. Okay, I just read the first two parts.
I think let's get back to context. The context is meditation, right? So I think let's not run away with the states and read the supplements at this stage. That's my personal opinion. But I think, just again rewinding to the specific question, what is still not clear to me is the use of the word absorption, but I will let that pass.
No, the other part is absorption in divinity. When we say nirvana is getting into that vacuum, absolute vacuum stage, which is the beginning of the seventh plane, why we use the term divinity here? That is what was in my mind. And we had a very fruitful, very nice discussion. Thank you.
Jay Baba, just one, clarification. What I've been doing is, this word reality and divinity is very confusing. Because if you do a control F find on the two words, and you will notice when you're reading God Speaks, I'll tell you one thing I notice. It says fana phila of reality and baka bila of divinity. So it is very contextual one way. And I think thanks to Ravi, he corrected me, because I was under the impression nirvana is also bliss, but it's not. It's only ordinary moksha. But what is happening in nirvana is you are actually experiencing the parapar parabrahma state, which is the absolute vacuum. And here the terminology that Baba used has absorption in divinity. That divinity is basically the parapar parabrahma state. Okay, because that is the absolute divine vacuum state, which can't be explained. Yeah. Baba in the supplement has given that only state 2, Paramatma, can be described by the perfect masters and avatar. But state 1, the beyond God state, which is called the most original beyond God state of God, is indescribable even by the prophets. So that is only an experience, and that experience is had during the Nirvana and then the Nirvikalpa Samadhi state. Then, as Ravi pointed out, is that I'll just read this. The experience of the first stage of Fana is of the Nirvana state. Nirvana is that state where apparently God is not. Look at the word, apparently God is not. This is the only state where God is not and consciousness is, which is what the super consciousness, Mahachaitanya. This experience of the first stage of Fana is what Buddha emphasized, but later on it was misinterpreted as Buddha having emphasized that there was no God. The reality, however, is that God is, but in the absolute vacuum state of the first stage of Fana, the consciousness remains experiencing absolute vacuum. As it, somebody has to mute, please. As it can never happen for God not to exist, as Ravi pointed out, as it can never happen for God not to exist in the state of Nirvana, God plays the part of consciousness itself, which consciousness is sometimes termed super consciousness or Mahachaitanya. The second stage of Fana follows this Nirvana state, and the I am God state is experienced consciously. However, it is only in some cases, see the word, however, it is only in some cases that the first stage of Fana is immediately followed by the second stage of Fana called Fana Phila, where the annihilated false and limited ego or I is replaced by the real and infinite unlimited I, on which the super consciousness now becomes automatically focused. Simultaneously, the absolute vacuum is automatically filled by the experience of the infinite. The super consciousness of God in the man state as man, now fixed and focused on the unlimited I, spontaneously identifies man with God the infinite. Simultaneously with the identification, the super consciousness of God the infinite experiences the I am God state. This is the goal. Attainment of the goal is to attain the Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Eva.
Can you please give the page number for where you read?
On 127, 128. God speaks.
Thank you.
Okay.
So just to summarize, Nirvana is absorption in divinity. Nirvikalpa Samadhi is divinity in expression. And Sahaja Samadhi is divinity in action. So that is how you can interpret this. Eva.
Kama, you can repeat those three terms.
Okay, first is first stage of Fana, Nirvana, absorption in divinity, which is what we discussed, is the absolute vacuum state, the super consciousness, Maha Chaitanya state. Then Nirvikalpa Samadhi, which is the I am God state, self-realization, God realization, Satchitananda, divinity in expression. It's a nice acronym, D-I-D-I-E, DIE. And the first one is AID, like aid, absorption in divinity. And then Sahaja Samadhi, which is called divinity in action, which the Sadguru school. And I think when Sahaja Samadhi is related to Jivan Mukta, I consider that as passive action. They really don't actively participate. They are indirectly, passively, you know, helping the human civilization. Whereas the Sadgurus are in divinity in action in Sahaja Samadhi and actively participating in the emancipation of human civilization.
Thank you.
I think for that lively discussion.
Page 278 table, if we can master that, because that's a beautiful summary of all the three different terminologies in Vedantic, Sufi, and Christian mystical terms, and the glossary in the God Speaks will help you to kind of look at all the definitions, because that's a very beautiful table. You know, if you can stick it up, you know, in your desk or whatever, it will help you a lot. Jai Baba.
all this only reinforces my thinking. It's too high stuff for me. I'm still trying to get all the terms into my head and wrap around it. So I think I'm just reconciled to the MOM, right? Which I keep saying. Minimum ordinary mukti. That seems to be my realistic goal.
Now, why Baba right. telling us all these things?
Uh-huh.
Baba is telling us when he is going to blindfold us and gives us fana, we're going to say, Baba, don't give us nirvana. Let us take a selfie. Hang in there.
Yeah. Good. So I think with that, let's just go to the table. The table is the table of general classification of the types of meditation. So first one is the varied forms of meditation before a person becomes an aspirant, that is before he gets into spirituality. Type two is the forms of meditation of the aspirant, which is a sadhak. Under that, there is A, B in type two. Type 2A is general meditation and the assimilation of divine truths. So under 2A, there is philosophical thinking, hearing discourses from the masters, and reading the written expositions of the masters. So there you go. We are 2A3 right now. We are in meditation, like Ashok said, and we are doing 2A3. Now you come to 2AB, forms of meditation of the aspirant, B, which is specialized meditation which selects some definite items of experience. In that, there are three subtypes. Meditation concerned with the objects of experience, meditation concerned with the subject of experience, and meditation concerned with mental operations or the combination of subject and object. Then you go to 3, which is Sahaja Samadhi or divinity in action of Sadhguru's the avatar. Here again, we just went through this in rather detail. Nirvana or absorption in divinity, Nirvikalpa Samadhi, which is divinity in expression, are the types. Going further, the general classification of the types of meditation has been given in table of general classification, which serves to summarize this chapter, part 3. Among the different kinds of meditation mentioned in this table, the varied forms of meditation that are encountered before becoming a sadhak have already been illustrated in the beginning of this part. The different forms of general meditation will be dealt with in part 4. The different forms of specialized meditation, along with their subdivisions, will each be explained individually in part 5 and 6. Nirvikalpa Samadhi and Sahaja Samadhi will be explained in parts 7 and 8. So maybe after we do 7 and 8, appropriate supplements, which I'd request Ashok and Kama to pick up, we should read at that time those specific supplements. After 7 and 8 is my thought process right now. Right.
Fair point.
So
I also wanted to say that you should just keep in mind, or my question is, the subject of experience and object of experience. We should look for the analogy or how to differentiate between that. When you were reading the table above, there's a mention of object of experience and subject of experience. So maybe probably in terms of our practical application and, you know, practice, we should keep that also in mind. I'm not very clear about that exactly.
Yes, we will wait till the other parts are read. They will be taken up in the different parts as explained.
Yes, Mama. Exactly. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. I think there's something wrong with your audio device this morning, Mamaji. So if you unmute, there's some noise that's coming along with it. So maybe you change something. Just saying it so that you can go back to what you were doing before. If that helps. Okay, let's go on to types of meditation, part 4. Part 4 is assimilation of the divine truths. Under that, section A, Modes of General Meditation. Subtitle is Limits of Philosophical Thinking. The beginnings of spiritual life are marked and helped by general meditation, which is not concerned exclusively with selected specific items of experience, but which in its comprehensive scope seeks to understand and assimilate the divine truths of life and the universe. When the aspirant is interested in the wider problems of the ultimate nature of life and the universe and begins to think about them, he may be said to have launched himself upon such meditation. Much of what is included in philosophy is a result of trying to develop an intellectual grasp of the ultimate nature of life and the universe. The purely intellectual grasp of divine truths remains feeble, incomplete, and indecisive owing to the limitations of the experiences that may be available as the foundation of the structures of speculation. The philosophical meditation that consists in free and unaided thinking does not lead to conclusive results. It often leads to diverse conflicting systems or views. Nevertheless, philosophical thinking is not without value. Besides leading the aspirant a certain extent into the realm of knowledge, it provides an intellectual discipline that enables him to receive and grasp divine truths when he happens to come upon them through those who know. Study of revealed truths. The more fruitful mode of general meditation consists in studying the revealed truths concerning life and the universe. This mode of understanding and assimilating the divine truths can start by hearing or reading expositions of the divine truth, which have their source in the masters of wisdom. The discourses or the writings of the avatar and the perfect masters, whether living or of the past, are suitable objects for this mode of general meditation because the assimilation of divine truths revealed through them enables the aspirant to bring his life into line with God's purpose in the universe. Jai Baba, we're doing just that. Value of hearing. The divine truths are most easily grasped and assimilated when they are passed on directly to the aspirant by a living master. Such personal communications of the master have a power and efficacy that can never belong to the information received by the aspirant through other sources. The word becomes alive and potent because of the life and personality of the master. Hence, many scriptures emphasize the need for hearing the divine truths directly through the spoken word of a master. The mode of general meditation that depends upon hearing expositions of the divine truths is undoubtedly the best when the aspirant has an opportunity to contact the living master and listen to him. Advantage of reading.
I have a question. So when Baba was in silence for 44 years, maybe even when he is communicating through the keyboard, can we treat it as speaking? Can we equate his communication of through the keyboard as speaking?
You could say that. You could even say the written word, right? So, but I think this is more a general observation, not self-referential, right? Baba is not referring to himself here. But yeah, I don't know. You could say gesturing and working on the keyboard also. I mean, the alphabet board is also to be taken as speaking. But I think he's more making a general observation on how the master's word listened to directly has the maximum impact, which is understandable.
Fair point.
Yeah. Next subtitle is Advantage of Reading. It is not always possible, however, for the aspirant to contact and listen to a living master. There you go. In such cases, meditation through reading has some advantages of its own. For the generality of aspirants, meditation through reading has hardly any suitable substitute because it starts from written expositions, which are available at any convenient time. Meditation that starts from reading about revealed truths has the special advantage of being easily accessible to most aspirants. Now we go to section B, which is reading as meditation. Meditation through reading has its handicaps because most written expositions of the divine truths are meant for intellectual study rather than for assimilation through meditation. The subtitle is also called Handicaps of Reading. The difficulties aspirants experience in this connection are due either to the fact that the method of meditation is not adapted to the subject matter or to some flaw in the method which makes it mechanical and uninspiring, or to the unwieldiness or vagueness of the subject matter used for meditation. Difficulties removed by specific meditation through reading. All these causes which vitiate meditation and make it unsuccessful have been avoided in the specific meditation recommended in this part. It is intended not only to explain the manner of carrying on meditation through reading, but also to provide an exposition of divine truths in order to fulfill the requirements of this form of meditation. The usual difficulties existing in meditation through reading have been removed in this specific meditation by ensuring that the process of meditation and the subject matter are adapted to each other and to the conditions of intelligent meditation. By elaborating the different phases of the meditation that starts from reading, and by providing a specially prepared brief exposition of the divine truths that is suitable and valuable subject matter for meditation through reading. The form of meditation that starts from reading about the divine truths has three stages. Again, the subtitle is Three Stages of Meditation Through Reading. In the first stage, the aspirant will have to read the exposition daily and simultaneously think about it thoroughly. In the second stage, actual reading becomes unnecessary, but the subject matter of the exposition is mentally revived and thought over constantly. In the third stage, it is quite unnecessary for the mind to revive the words in the exposition separately and consecutively, and all discursive thinking about the subject matter comes to an end. At this stage of meditation, the mind is no longer occupied with any train of thought, but has a clear, spontaneous, and intuitive perception of the sublime truths expressed in the exposition. Since intelligent meditation consists in thorough thinking about a particular subject, it follows that the best help for meditation would be a brief and clear exposition of the subject of meditation. The subtitle is also Subject of Meditation. The following concise exposition of the divine truths comprises the whole story of creation, as well as a complete account of the spiritual path and the goal of self-realization. The aspirant can intelligently read the exposition and assimilate the sublime truths it embodies. Brief exposition for meditation through reading. This special form of meditation is extremely easy and useful because reading the subject matter and thinking about it have to be done simultaneously. Further, by making the exposition of the subject clear and concise, the probability of any disturbance arising out of irrelevant thoughts is eliminated. It is extremely difficult to avoid the disturbance of irrelevant thoughts while meditating upon some lengthy essay or book, even if it is committed to memory. Spontaneous meditation about it therefore becomes impracticable. The appearance of irrelevant thoughts becomes very probable in lengthy meditation on abstract ideas or on some concrete object of experience. But irrelevant thoughts are extremely improbable if the subject matter used for meditation consists of a brief exposition of the supersensible truth. If the aspirant meditates upon the following exposition of the divine truths in the manner that has been indicated above, meditation will become not only spontaneous and easy, delightful and inspiring, but also helpful and successful. The aspirant will thus be taking a very important step toward the realization of the goal of life. Section C, the divine
Karthik.
Yeah.
The three stages of meditation through reading, that I think may be repeated, it's quite very, very relevant.
Sure. So it's the three stages of meditation through reading. In the first stage, the aspirant will have to read the expression daily and simultaneously think about it thoroughly. In the second stage, actual reading becomes unnecessary, but the subject matter of the expression is mentally revived and thought over constantly. In the third stage, it is quite unnecessary for the mind to revive the words in the exposition separately and consecutively, and all discursive thinking about the subject matter comes to an end. At this stage of meditation, the mind is no longer occupied with any train of thought, but has a clear, spontaneous, and intuitive perception of the sublime truths expressed in the exposition. So words are read over and over again, first time. Yes, second, yes, the meaning is focused on. And third, I think you go beyond the meaning to actually internalize and start putting that the thoughts behind it, the concepts behind it. Yeah, go ahead.
The third paragraph is quite profound in the sense that it's a sort of a technique of manonash in a particular area of understanding. So where you are going to be blind to that after understanding. So you absorbed everything and it remains there and the mind doesn't act further on that issue because you are very clear about it. It has become a part of you. So this is quite a profound paragraph, third paragraph. Any other inputs on this?
Interesting.
Mamaji, if I may add, this is a way to increase your concentration and focus on a particular part which you have read, and you, as Karthik said, internalize it. That means first you read, second you the actual reading becomes unnecessary, and in the third stage you are basically, you know, you don't even need to read or even think about it. It becomes a part of your DNA.
Yes, that's a very profound
anybody
way.
Anybody else on... Correct. Go ahead.
Any other views on this? I got a lot of insight, sudden awakening here. Thank you.
So I think you have internalized and moved to stage three. Congratulations. We are still in reading stage, so I'll continue reading. Okay, so section C, the divine truths for meditation through reading, the journey of the soul to the oversoul. So I think this is a very beautiful section, and again I'm again reminded of the third session on God Speaks that Watt Parks did. So you'll relate to that video when we finish reading this now. So at the core of all of Baba's work is the doctrine of the divine theme. And I think that was my significant takeaway from that a session, which, as I already mentioned, I heard multiple times, and I exhort all of you to try to catch up on that as well. But and a reminder, tomorrow 4 p.m. is the live session. For some reason, the questions don't show up. So if you want to really interact, go live rather than rely on the video, right? So yeah, with that, let me read The Journey of the Soul to the Oversoul. Soul and its illusion.
Just Karthik, before you start that.
Sure.
So you said it is live session tomorrow. Uh-huh. So is it through Google?
Yeah, there is a Google Talk link I received. Yes. I messed up last Sunday where I was not available at that time. So I thought I'll anyway catch up with that in video form. I mean, on YouTube in video form. But unfortunately, I don't think they capture all of the questions. They just abruptly ended it. And it was just 45 minutes of recorded video that's there as part of session 3. I have requested through Soma to try to get access to the questions and also the slides. The slides are very useful, but then we hardly get a chance to read them because he just shows and then he goes on, right? So I've asked for a copy of the slides as well. So when I make progress or when Soma makes progress, we'll all benefit.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so I'll continue. The journey of the soul to the oversoul. Atma or the soul is in reality identical with Paramatma or the oversoul, which is one, infinite and eternal. The soul is in fact beyond the gross, subtle and mental worlds. The subtitle is Soul and its Illusion. But it experiences itself as being limited owing to its identification with the sharir, sthula sharir or gross body, the prana, sukshma sharir or subtle body, which is the vehicle of desires and vital forces, and the manas, karana sharir or mental body, which is the seat of the mind. The soul, in its transcendental state, is one, formless, eternal, and infinite, and yet identifies itself with the phenomenal world of forms, which are many and finite and destructible. This is Maya or cosmic illusion. States of phenomenal world. The phenomenal world of finite objects is utterly illusory and false. It has three states, the gross, the subtle, and the mental. Although all three of these states of the world are false, they represent different degrees of falseness. Thus, the gross world is farthest from truth, God. The subtle world is nearer truth, and the mental world is nearest to truth. All three states of the world owe their existence to cosmic illusion, which the soul has to transcend before it realizes the truth. Purpose of creation. The sole purpose of creation is for the soul to enjoy the infinite state of the oversoul consciously. Although the soul eternally exists in and with the oversoul in an inviolable unity, it cannot be conscious of this unity independently of creation, which is within the limitations of time. It's a fantastic line. I'm going to read it again. Although the soul eternally exists in and with the oversoul in an inviolable unity, it cannot be conscious of this unity independently of creation, which is within the limitations of time. It must, therefore, evolve consciousness before it can realize its true status and nature as being identical with the infinite oversoul, which is one without a second. The evolution of consciousness requires the duality of subject and object, the center of consciousness, and the environment, that is the world of forms. Cause of cosmic illusion. How does the soul get caught up in illusion? How did the formless, infinite, and eternal soul come to experience itself as having form and as being finite and destructible? How did Purusha, or the Supreme Spirit, come to think of itself as Prakriti, or the world of nature? In other words, what is the cause of the cosmic illusion in which the individualized soul finds itself? to realize the true status of the Oversoul, which is one, indivisible, real, and infinite, the soul needs consciousness. The soul does get consciousness. However, this consciousness is not of God, but of the universe, not of the Oversoul, but of its shadow, not of the one, but of many, not of the infinite, but of the finite, not of the eternal, but of the transitory. Thus, the soul, instead of realizing the Oversoul, gets involved in the cosmic illusion, and hence, though really infinite, it comes to experience itself as finite. In other words, when the soul develops consciousness, it does not become conscious of its own true nature, but of the phenomenal world, which is its own shadow. Evolution and degrees of consciousness. In order to become conscious of the phenomenal world, the soul must assume some form as its medium for experiencing the world. And the degree and kind of consciousness are determined by the nature of the form used as the medium. The soul first becomes conscious of the gross world through a gross form. The consciousness of the gross world that it has in the beginning is of the most partial and rudimentary type. Correspondingly, the soul assumes the most undeveloped form, that of stone. I think there's a reference to the gases. Yeah. So for earlier identification of the soul with gaseous forms, see God Speaks. So before stone, there is gas. Driving force of evolution, next subtitle. The driving force of evolution consists in the momentum consciousness receives owing to the conservation of the impressions, sanskaras, left by diverse desires or conditions. Thus, the sanskaras cultivated in a particular form have to be worked out and fulfilled through the medium of a higher form and a correspondingly more developed consciousness of the gross world. The soul, therefore, has to assume higher and higher forms like metal, vegetable, worm, fish, bird, and animal, until at last it assumes a human form in which it has fully developed consciousness in all the aspects of knowing, feeling, and willing of the gross world. The manner in which sanskaras result in the evolution of consciousness and the corresponding forms has a useful analog in ordinary experience. If a man has the desire to act the part of a king on the stage, he can only experience it by actually putting on the garb of a king and going on the stage. This is true of aspirations and desires. They can only be worked out and fulfilled by bringing about an actual change in the entire situation as well as the medium through which the situation may be adequately experienced. The parallel is very helpful in understanding the driving force of evolution, which is not mechanical, but purposive. Watt Parks uses teleological, which also we have discussed earlier, right? Identification with forms. The sanskaras are not only responsible for the evolution of the form, body, and the kind of consciousness connected with it, but they are also responsible for the riveting of consciousness to the phenomenal world. They make emancipation of consciousness, that is, the withdrawal of consciousness from the phenomenal world to the soul itself, impossible at the subhuman stage and difficult at the human level. Since consciousness clings to the previous sanskaras and experience of the phenomenal world, is conditioned by the use of an adequate form, body, as a medium, the soul at every stage of evolution comes to identify itself with the form. Thus, the soul, which in reality is infinite and formless, experiences itself as finite and thinks of itself as being stone, metal, vegetable, worm, fish, bird, or animal according to the degree of the development of consciousness. Finally, while experiencing the gross world through the human form, the soul thinks that it is a human being. Reincarnation and law of karma. The soul has fully developed and complete consciousness in the first human form, and therefore there is no need for any further evolution of the gross form, body. The evolution of forms thus comes to an end with the attainment of the human form. To experience the sanskaras cultivated in the human form, the soul has to reincarnate again and again in human forms. The innumerable human forms through which the soul has to pass are determined by the law of karma, or the nature of its previous sanskaras, whether of virtue or vice, happiness or misery. During these lives, the soul, which is eternal, identifies itself with the gross body, which is destructible. Subtle and mental bodies. While developing full consciousness of the gross world, the soul simultaneously develops the subtle and mental bodies. But as long as its consciousness is confined to the gross world alone, it cannot use these bodies consciously in wakefulness. It becomes conscious of these bodies and the corresponding worlds only when its full consciousness turns inward, that is, toward itself. When the soul is conscious of the subtle world through the subtle body, it identifies itself with the subtle body, and when it is conscious of the mental world through the mental body, it identifies itself with the mental body, just as it identifies itself with the gross body when it is conscious of the gross world through gross body. Spiritual path. The homeward journey of the soul consists in freeing itself from the illusion of being identical with its bodies, gross, subtle, and mental. When the attention of the soul turns towards self-knowledge and self-realization, there is a gradual loosening and disappearance of the sanskaras that keep consciousness turned toward the phenomenal world. Disappearance of the sanskaras proceeds side by side with piercing through the veil of cosmic illusion. And the soul not only begins to transcend the different states of the phenomenal world, but also to know itself as different from its bodies. The spiritual path begins when the soul tries to find itself and turns its full consciousness towards God. Towards truth, God. At the first stage, the soul becomes totally unconscious of its gross body and of the gross world, and experiences the subtle world through the medium of its subtle body, which it identifies itself. In the second stage, the soul is totally unconscious of its gross and subtle bodies, and also of the gross and subtle worlds, and experiences the mental world through the medium of its mental body, with which it now identifies itself. At this stage, the soul may be said to be face to face with God or the Oversoul, which it recognizes as infinite. But though it recognizes the infinity of the Oversoul, which it objectifies, it looks upon itself as being finite because of its identification with the mental body or mind. Thus,
I have a question, Karthik.
Sure.
So we have a gross body and we have a gross mind. What about the people in the second, the third, and fourth planes? They have gross body and they have gross sanskaras. They live in the gross. I'm sorry. They have subtle body, but they still have gross body. They have subtle body and they live in the subtle world. So how do we equate? So gross body, we have, if we compare a gross conscious human being versus subtle conscious human being, we both have gross bodies. We have gross mind and they have subtle mind. Is that right?
So I think this is referred to elsewhere. I don't know. Yeah, go ahead, Kama.
I think in God Speaks, it's mentioned. See, basically what happens is when you are in the gross world, you are directly using your gross body because you have gross sanskaras. So let me rephrase it. When you have gross sanskaras, when you are a human being, then you are basically working on your gross sanskaras. The gross sanskaras makes you use your gross body to experience the gross world. So we go through the duality of experiences, you know, the reincarnation, spending sanskaras, creating new sanskaras. And finally, when we are ready for the involution state, we start to have finer desires and we start transforming the gross sanskaras to subtle sanskaras. Once all gross sanskaras transform to subtle sanskaras, that subtle sanskaras will make you directly use your subtle body to experience the subtle world, but you are also indirectly using the gross body and the mental body. See, the mind is the mental body. It is not a subtle body. Similarly, when we go to the fifth and sixth plane, the subtle sanskaras have been converted to mental sanskaras. So the mental sanskaras will make use of the mental body to experience the mental world, but indirectly use the gross body and subtle body because you're living, you know, on the phenomenal world. That is how it is. There is an explanation on that in God Speaks. I'll find out which page or something like that.
Kama, if I can help you out, or can I help everybody out? I think part one, states of consciousness, and on page two, there's a table, sphere, body. And that could be of relevance here. I think the first seven pages of God Speaks might be relevant if you want
but
to.
But you understand my question, right? You understand my question, right? So let's say we are experiencing the gross world and our sanskaras are gross. So we experience the mind is also, we have the mind, we experience the mind. We experience the sanskaras through the mind. Gross sanskaras through the gross mind. So in the subtle world, the subtle person, the must, he has a gross body like us. But his sanskaras are very subtler than gross. So he has got a subtle mind. So he experiences the subtle world through the subtle mind. So his mind is different from gross mindedness. So he still has gross body, but the mind is subtle mind.
Ravi, I'm sorry just to say you're incorrect. You know, it is very clearly said, there is nothing like a subtle mind or a gross mind. The definition of mind is a mental body, which is basically the repository of the sanskaras. The sanskaras are then expressed to the subtle body and then experienced through the gross body. So the mind is technically the mental body. Yes, what you're asking is the mas who are in the planes, subtle or mental, definitely as per the God Speaks, like I said, you know, I'm not able to articulate the exact sentence. I'll find the page, but I also had that question quite a while ago. So your question is very correct. What you're doing is that your subtle, because the mas are in the subtle world, they are going to, their gross sanskaras have become subtle sanskaras. See, sanskaras is what drives the human being to do action of thoughts, words, and deeds. So what is happening here is when you have subtle impressions, then you use the subtle body directly and indirectly use the mental body and the gross body when you're in the, when you're experiencing the subtle world. And so on and so forth.
What is a subtle body?
Subtle body is basically the energy part, the feelings, the emotions.
So whatever we say, our mind now is the subtle body?
Yes. Yes.
Only thing is sanskaras are different.
Okay.
Yeah, it's
like I said.
We have gross sanskaras. They have subtler sanskaras.
Yes, exactly. Like, let's go a reverse way. Like,
so that's what I was saying, right? The mind, we have the gross mind. We experience everything through the gross sanskaras. They experience through their mind subtle sanskaras.
See, don't use the word gross mind or subtle.
Yes, yes. Yes, Ravi, you don't use the gross mind and subtle mind. Those terminologies look very wrong. Yeah. Mind is a single entity. But
so many can... okay, I don't use it. So okay. I use my mind with the gross sanskaras. So third plane person uses the mind with the subtle sanskaras.
No. Remember, yes. There is a sanskaras drive our action. Forget the mind. Mind, mental body is a repository, the storage. You know, that is where the mind ego is, the ego personality self. It is a repository of all the good and bad sanskaras. And what you're doing is the sanskaras determine your action. So the action of thoughts creates mental impressions. The action of words creates subtle impressions, and the action of deeds creates gross impressions or sanskaras. It is very clearly given in God Speaks about this question that you're having, you know, what happens to people in the subtle planes and in the mental plane. So it is about actually, see, let's take us as an example. Let's say all of us are in the gross plane because we have gross impressions. We have not got into the subtle world because we still have gross impressions. So what we are doing is we are using our gross body with the five physical senses, touch, taste, sound, smell, sight. We are experiencing the gross world, the phenomenal world, which is outside of us. But what we are doing is we are indirectly using our indirectly experiencing the subtle world and mental world. Like mental world is about thoughts, correct? And the subtle world is about feelings and desires. But it's an indirect aspect. The direct aspect is the gross impression, experiencing the gross world. I don't know whether I made sense, Bob.
Yeah, but this needs to be some serious thinking and
In fact, we are way out of time. In fact, we should be reading this again. I want to read this divine theme exposition again. We'll read it from the beginning tomorrow when we start. And and let's reflect more on the bodies, the worlds, and the progress of the soul, right? On that note, we can wrap up for today. And just a reminder to Nomita that we do the meditation tomorrow. Now I see that she's online. So she does the meditation after we finish maybe one chapter. We'll finish this chapter tomorrow and then one more. And then we can do a round of meditation. Jai Baba. So have a great Saturday.
I remember.
Thank you. So have a great Saturday, everybody. And use your time. If you find time, please listen to the video. Please read a little more. And do some meditation if possible. And let's catch up tomorrow morning.
Karthik, one quick thing. Just one addition here to answer Ravi's question.
Ravi.
I think if people can look at page numbers 115, 116 in God Speaks, I think it will give you explanation of his question, answer to his question. And also as a footnote, what we just read today, the last section C that you're reading is God Speaks in a nutshell, actually, if you look at it.
Exactly.
Yes.
What did you say, Kama, 115?
Yes, 115 onwards, you can read God Speaks, and that will give you the explanation that you're looking for.
115, okay.
115.
See, okay. One more thing I remembered, human beings have sensual feelings for sex, right? And the people with the subtle world, they also have sexual feelings, but it's approximately half, that's what Baba wrote, half how human beings feel in the grass world. So they also have all these feelings.
But yes, but it is not expressed. They are not expressed in gross form. It is sublimated. You rightly said that is in the chapter, the last chapter, God is infinite love. What you are saying, the whole thing is explaining that, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Well, what you are talking about, lust. Lust is lust, 50% in the subtle world, subtle planes. And in the mental aspect, it becomes one-fourth. But it is not expressed in subtle form. It is only expressed in mental form. It is the thought of lust. Then the desire, yes, the expression of it. Then you convert the expression into the actual deed. That becomes the gross aspect. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Like you use the word, you know, I'm getting horny, you know. Sorry about that. Okay, Baba.
Jesus Christ, man. I thought you were married, Kama.
So what? What's that? Anyway, on that very note.
This is Saturday morning for you guys. You should have coffee and breakfast. Jai Baba, everyone. Keep Baba in thoughts, not other things.